Hi there and welcome back. Today we've got a demo for you around SFTP connecting to data factories. So this is for when you've got loads of files going onto a server and you want to collect those every day or once an hour or that kind of thing. We're going to be using the same techniques that we used in the BigQuery demo, using variables based on time and doing kind of time slicing of the data. So the demo includes everything you need, including some data. I've written a script there so that on the Linux box it's going to generate the data for you, so you don't need to worry about that kind of thing. So enjoy the demo and please hit the subscribe button down below. It really helps the channel to kind of show up in feeds and raises the profile a little bit so that more people get to see the content here. Thanks very much, enjoy the demo. So for this demo, we're going to deploy a SFTP server. In this instance, the SFTP server is going to be Ubuntu. So pretty much you can use any Ubuntu or any Linux, in fact. What we're going to be using is an SFTP server, and this uses the SSH service, which is generally on by default in any modern Linux distro. So go into the portal and create a new resource. And choose your favorite Linux. In this case, it's Ubuntu. And then give it a name. Here I've used SFTP Ingest. And choose a region. I generally use East US because everything is available in that region. So we're going to use standard passwords. Obviously, in production, you would be using SSH public keys. But for this demo, that we're not really concentrating on the security side. So I've used demo god as the username, as is standard in these demos. Just makes it nice and easy to remember. And for the inbound port rules, we're going to open port 22, which is the standard SSH port, which will allow us to connect from the data factory instance. If you were doing this on an internal SFTP server, then it's possible that you might be using a data gateway or integration runtime to connect to that instead of opening the port. So we didn't really change anything else, so just next and create. And that's going to take a few minutes to run through the deployment of the virtual machine. For the video, I've sped all of this up, obviously. So in real life, it will take you a few minutes longer than this. Next, we're going to connect to that machine. So click on the connect button on the menu. And we're going to copy this IP address, which is the public IP of the server. And I'm going to use PuTTY to connect. It's a pretty good lightweight SSH tool. So just put in the password for the DemoGod account and get yourself logged in. And once you're logged in, what we're going to do is create a script file and copy the code for that script file from the Git repository. So we're using Nano in this instance as the editor, and just creating a file and copying this code. So what this code does is, you can see there's a for value in 1 to 100. This is gonna iterate 100 times, and there's going to be a random sleep, so it'll wait a minute, 2 minutes between each run, and it's then going to create a file, and it's going to just put a random number in with a timestamp. So then we save that as createcsvdata.sh, and then we use chmod 744 to make it executable so that we can actually run that. And then you can run the script just by doing ./ and running it. That is going to take a while to run because of the random sleep in between each iteration of it. So if you want to just minimize that window and carry on with the demo, that's just going to carry on for a while. So next we're going to create a storage account. This is going to be the sync for our data. We can use SFTP as a data sync as well. But in this instance, we're going to use Blob as a sort of placeholder for a data lake. So again, we're going to put it into the SFTP ingest resource group.
And we're going to give the storage account a name, which is SFTP Ingest 2019. Obviously now we'd be using 2020, but I recorded these videos a little while ago and only now getting to publish them, so that's the previous year. So go ahead and create that, and once that's completed, we're then going to go in and create a container. So it shouldn't take too long to create, and then we're going to go and click on blobs. I believe that that's now been renamed to containers within the interface, so don't be alarmed if it looks a bit different. It's still the same button in the same position. But we're just creating a container here. So call the container SFTP ingest. This might also be labeled as sync or whatever in your real data lake. Or you might name it after the SFTP server, so it's easy to find that information that you're importing. And finally, we're going to go in and create another new resource. Do a search for data factory and select that data factory. You can also obviously click the deploy button in the GitHub repository, and that will deploy all of these things for you. But I'm showing it here just to be thorough for the video and to show every single step. So again, we're going to give it a name. Here it has to be a unique name, so you might need to put the current date after that. And again, we'll put it into that same SFTP ingest resource group. We're not going to enable Git for this. Some of you may have seen the recent Data Factory DevOps integration video that I did. If not, go and check it out now. We strongly recommend that that's the way that you start deploying these going forwards. Certainly at scale, it makes things easier to keep track of and to test and those sorts of things. So now we're going to go and hit the author and monitor button in our data factory once it finishes deploying. This will take you into the designer interface, and we'll just go straight to the edit button and click connections. Here we're going to add connections for Azure Blob Storage. And this is going to be the data sync. And this one's pretty straightforward because it's obviously connecting to an Azure service, so you just choose it from the list. So drop down the subscription. And then drop down the storage account name and choose the SFTP ingest account that we created earlier. And then always hit the test connection button. Very important part. We're pretty confident it's going to work between Data Factory and Blob Storage, but it's good to just get into the practice of testing each connection as you do it. It saves a whole bunch of heartache later when you have to troubleshoot or debug these things after you've got data sets on. So for the second link service, do a search for SFTP. Bear in mind this is different to the FTP connector. SFTP and FTP are different protocols. SFTP is based on SSH, while FTPS is just an FTP server with a certificate. Standard FTP is not in particularly wide use anymore, which is why we're doing this demo with SFTP. So here we're going to copy the IP address of that host. In a production environment, you'd be using host names, obviously, but we'll paste that in, and that came from the Azure dashboard, and then we're going to choose basic authentication and put in our demo god username and password. And again, doing a test connection that was successful, and then finishing. So the next step, we're going to hit the datasets button and add the two datasets to go with this. First up, we're going to do a source dataset on the SFTP. And create a couple of parameters. So this is exactly the same technique that we were using on the BigQuery demo right back about a year ago now. You can go and check that video out or take a look in the GitHub. In the SFTP source, we're going to choose the link service, and when we logged in as DemoGod on the Linux machine, it just created a data folder within the home folder of the DemoGod account. You can see there that some of the files have been created. That script may well still be running while you're doing this. That's fine. And it will help to show the tumbling window effect. As new data is created, new tumbling window triggers are created, and it will then go and pick up any new data. So we'll go and get the schema in from what is there now. We do that before we put in these parameters, so that it just gets any file from the share. And then we're going to filter by the last modified date. So don't forget that these files are being created over time. There's a random sleep in between creating each of them. And this is to show how it would work in a real production environment. So generally, your systems will be dumping files onto the folder. As for the Azure Blob Sync, we're literally just going to dump them into the one folder and not do anything particularly complicated. So often people ask, how do we delete the files from the source in this? Generally, I would recommend not to delete the files from the source as part of this process. This is a data ingest process. If any data then later changes, we want to be able to rerun a previous tumbling window and go back and get that data again. So please try and treat the data lifecycle as a separate process to the data ingest process. So on that SFTP server, you might have a shell script that runs once a day and clears up files older than a certain date. You might also have some kind of archiving. Do not ever think of your blob store or your data lake as an archive. It's a different purpose. So if you do want an archive, have a proper archiving solution that's got managed life cycles on there. So once we finish the data sets, we just create a copy data job in the pipeline, and we're going to put the source and the sync in as the two data sets. And again, we're just pulling these pipeline variables parameters through from the pipeline, pushing them into the source so that it can then use them to find the modified data of the files. On the Azure Blob, we don't need that. And then on the mapping, we're literally just going to map one to one. So then we're going to validate everything. That should just validate. It's a fairly simple pipeline. And then we'll publish the entire thing. Once that's successfully published, we're going to create a new trigger. And here we're going to use a tumbling window trigger, just like on that the big query demo that we did. But this time we're going to set the tumbling window to start today, whatever date that you run this, because the files that are created on the Linux system are going to be created in real time when you run that script. So choose a time slightly before your script was run, then choose an end time that's maybe half an hour into the future, and bear in mind that once you've finished this, you're going to be deleting everything to avoid getting charged for the demo environment going forwards. So you can leave that at every 15 minutes, and it will then go and create a run of this pipeline for every 15-minute window from the start time to the end time, and it will get every file that was modified within that window. This is important because in, for instance, a retail environment where maybe you've added a sale that fitted into a certain window, you might update that file later and go back and reprocess it. So you can actually go back and rerun individual trigger runs to update data after it's been changed. So then we're going to publish the tumbling window trigger. That will then create the runs for any windows in the past. It doesn't create the runs for the future yet. Those get created as those times tick over. So if we now go over to the monitoring, we can see in my instance it's created three of them because there have been three of those windows. And we can see they're starting to succeed. So if we click on the view button, we can see what happened within there. And go into details, we should be able to see how many files were written, how much data was moved, that kind of stuff. So in this instance, zero files were written. So obviously that was a pipeline run that was before any files were created, and therefore there are none with that modified date. Then we're going into this second one, hitting the details button again. Seven files have been copied, so seven files in that 15-minute window were created. And if you were to sit around and wait for a while, then you would see a new pipeline run is going to get created and new files are going to be created at the same time and copied across. So if we now come back into the blob store and just take a look at the files that are in there, we can see all of those files that have been copied across. And we can open one up and just see the random data that was created in there. Obviously, this data won't be particularly interesting. It will just be a couple of columns with a date and a random number. But you can then go back onto your Linux server and kind of see that data has been copied across. So that's the whole demo for today. Hope you enjoyed it. Please, again, go back and hit that subscribe button, hit the like button, and we'll see you next time for the next demo. Thanks very much.